Tada. Zahrajem tovim, chavrim shili. Ani, mayat Mr. R. But this will be my most shitty talk ever. And it is basically because for this talk, I built a small demo application which automates the most critical system in your life. I mean, everything in this system in a bathroom has to go well. Otherwise, we end up in shitty situations. So for example, we could donate something, and we could donate something more, and maybe you donate even more, and then you get a toilet overflow exception. So these are critical systems, and you have to get them right. So let's flush and get that beautiful duck back in there. And of course, this process can be automated, so we have one single button to pay a full visit, which does it all automatically for us. So today I'm talking about Mobix State Tree, and it basically started out as an experiment, and then people started using it in production. That's the risk of open source. But basically it was about taking all the cool ideas of React and applying it to data in general. So React, for example, the thing I love about it is that it allows you to compose your UI, your components, in a very declarative way. And it's easy to follow, and you can break it down. So you can imagine that this bathroom application just composes a few other components. And you can zoom into them and see their details. And so Mobix State Tree is a library on top of Mobix which structures how you work with data. So it starts by allowing you to define the structure of your data, the structure of the JSON you receive from your server at Cedra. So the duck in our application is just a very simple model which has a single attribute of the type string. And this might to you look very familiar to prop types in React. They work roughly the same. And so we have also a piece of shit, and it's expressed using weight and smell. We have some default values so that we can infer the types from it. And now we can compose this nicely. So for example, if you have a toilet, it has a flushing state. Very important. But it also has a pile. And pile is an array of the union of those two earlier types. And so we can move on and on and introduce bathroom, which composes some more types. So that's basically shamelessly ripping off an ID from React. So where React composes a tree of component instances, Mobix State Tree composes a tree of rich type instances. And types, they don't just describe the shape of your data, they also enrich them, for example, by allowing you to define actions on them or having local state which is not accessible from the outside. So basically, it works by two main things. The one is the types, and the other is what we call snapshots, raw, immutable pieces of data you might, for example, receive from your backend. So here is the state describing our entire bathroom. And then we can pass that snapshot to a type, and then we get a rich tree of types. And so on these types, you can define actions which move the entire tree to the next state. And after that, we can even go back to this raw data we started with and get that JSON out of our tree again. And that is a very interesting process because it's reactive, and because it uses structural sharing, it's very cheap. So what we can do, for example, in this demo application is we grab some JSON from our local storage, we instantiate our type, and then we render it into our component tree. That component will probably modify this data in the future. And whenever there's a change, that will produce a new snapshot. And we can write that thing back to our local storage. So pretty straightforward. Another cool thing about React is that it's contract-based. So the only way you talk to components is through props. And what BigStateTree basically provides the same. You define the shape of your props, which are read-only, the views on your data, and also the actions. And that allows us to encapsulate our internal state to protect it and to do both runtime or design time type checking, especially if you're using TypeScript. So this is how we define both actions and local state in Mobix State Tree. So we have a drain socket, and that is very similar to web sockets you might be familiar with. And the important thing is that they set up a connection to which you can push your current pile. And then we can expose one single action from the type, which is flush. And then calling an action is as simply as doing any normal JavaScript method call. But there's more. React offers a lifecycle, and it offers dependency injection. So React tells you when an instance of your component is entering the DOM and leaving the DOM. And that allows you to clean up stuff, which is important in the bathroom. And so Mobix State Tree allows you to find hooks on your data as well. So whenever, for some reason, data is removed from your state, some hooks will be triggered so that you can clean up the connections you have. You can close your socket. Because if you don't close the drain socket when you unmount a bathroom, you get quite a mess. And more importantly, there is instance reconciliation. And most people think that's mainly important for performance because, well, you can reuse pieces of your DOM. But it's also very important because it allows components to preserve their local state. So for example, when you have some input widget and you pass in a prop giving it a new border color, for example, then the value inside that component is preserved, even though you called it or changed it from outside. And this is something quite unique that Mobix State Tree offers as well. So say that you have this tree of your data with all the local state initialized and the socket connections being started, etc. And then you receive a new snapshot from the server. The Mobix State Tree will ensure that this new snapshot is applied with the minimum amount of required changes. And as it applies the snapshot, it will trigger the lifecycle hooks for data that gets removed or gets added. But it will also preserve all the local state as far as is possible. Just like React does for your component tree, we do here for data. So basically, Mobix State Tree is React, but for data. And so here's a small dictionary. Now the interesting thing is that it started out as an experiment. So I just tried to put all the fancy stuff in there. And it offers you three very relevant pieces of tools helping you to reason about your data in a very generic way. And so the first one are snapshots I already told you about. They are basically a representation of your entire state at one moment in time. So this is very comparable to the state in, for example, Redux. And now you can compare snapshots basically with a Git commit. They capture the entire state of your entire repository at a single moment in time. But they do not store the entire state. They use structural sharing, but they capture it. It's the concept of the entire state, immutable. And then there are also JSON patches. And patches are an official standard that describes how your data moves from one state to the next. So how your data is modified. So you can reason about it in a very fine-grained manner. You know exactly what changes. So this is a patch which is produced if you donate something in the toilet to the pile, and a simple object gets pushed. And JSON patches are just like Git patches. They describe how to transition from one state to the next. And middleware, well, before the lunch you heard everything about middleware. Thanks, Boris, wherever you are. So middleware, they're like Git hooks, allowing you to intercept commands before they are executed or after they are executed. Now, what can we do with that? That's where it gets interesting. So first, let me show you a minimal middleware. And a middleware is basically a function that receives a description of the call and a next function that actually executes it, either by invoking the next middleware or by invoking the actual implementation. So here, we have a real problem to solve. How to take a dump atomically. And you might be wondering, why is that a problem? This is why that might be a problem. Suppose that you go to the toilet, you donate something there, and then you figure, wait, there's not enough paper left. And I can assure you that happens quite quickly. Probably your mother teaches you to check your prerequisites, but, well, sometimes we just forget. So what happens if we do that in this application? We pay for full visit, and we need two pieces of toilet paper, but we have only one. So what will happen? We get an out of toilet paper exception. Of course, right? You could have predicted that. But now we're in quite a shitty situation, because our state is kind of broken, because this process wasn't atomic. So now we're left here, and it's up to you how to fix this. So this is quite a critical process, and it should be atomic. And if you picture this in a timeline, we start with the zero state, or the duck state, and then we donate something, take a paper, and we flush. That's what we want to do, right? Over time. But then we get the exception, which is bad. So what we want to do is to roll back to our stable state, which in this case is the duck state. Now that is a problem we can generically solve, scary, by using middleware. And what I can do is I can just decorate the exposed function with the atomic middleware, which I already prepared. And decorate is just a function that adds middleware to one specific method. So if you save this, we go back to our demo, reset our state. So now we're going to pay again the full visit. We again get the exception, of course, because in the middle of the process it dies. But if we hide exception, our state has been restored to what it originally was. So how can you express that using middleware? Well, it's actually pretty simple. When our middleware is called, we quickly create a snapshot of the current state, which, as said, is cheap. Then we run the call, the action. And if that throws, we just apply our original snapshot back to our tree. OK, but that is not a realistic encoding of this process, because in real life, it more looks like this. I mean, often paying a visit takes some time, right? You may be playing a game meanwhile. And so that exception might only occur after a while. In other words, it might be an asynchronous process. How do you get exceptions in asynchronous processes? So what we want to express is that between every step, we wait a bit. And we could express that by using, for example, async await, where the delay method is just a promise that resolves after 1 second. That's how you can easily write delay. But actually, we don't use async await in MobXA3. You can use it, but there is something better. And something better is generators. Asynchronous processes are first class supported in MobXA3. And they're based on generators for one reason only, and that's the fact that generators allow you to intercept whenever a process continues. unlike async await. That's probably also one of the reasons why Redux Saga uses generators as well. And so it works basically the same as async away. It's just slightly different syntax. Instead of async, we have a star function, a generator function. And instead of await, we have yields. And beyond that, the semantics are the same. And now we're going to our demo, and we're going to run the same process. So we pay a visit, we play a little game, we wipe, and then we run out of paper. Aye. And if you now hide the exception, our middleware isn't sufficient enough anymore, because it did just a try-catch, but it was on a completely different stack, so our failing promise will not be catched by this middleware. Or to put it in a picture, now all these steps are individual stacks in your JavaScript engine. And the exception only happens in a far future. So how can we rewind to the first state? Well, because asynchronous actions are first class, we can actually express this. And we can do that by, which I prepared for this demo, the atomic async middleware. So we swap the middleware with a slightly more advanced one. We go to the demo. We go again to this state. We start our process. We play a little game. Wait for it. Boom. We get our exception back. But if you hide it, we see that we nicely have rewinded to our original duck state. And the way to express this is pretty simple. We keep a small map for all the actions that are being started, all the processes that are being spawned. And for each process, we store the snapshot at the point when it started. And so if that process ends with a rejection, then we just apply that snapshot to our tree. And this way, we can suddenly reason about asynchronous processes. Now, this looks pretty fancy because you can rewind asynchronous processes. But in practice, it works pretty bad. And the reasons for that is that basically snapshots are too naive to do real-world time traveling. And I can demonstrate that very easily. So let's say we start the same process over again. And in the meantime, I start moving this painting around. And now the exception occurs, and we take a look at our application. And the toilet is back to a stable state. But also, our painting has moved back. But the painting didn't relate to that failing process at all. Maybe this is another actor in your system moving that painting. It might be incoming chases from the server. And you don't want to play those back. That doesn't make any sense. So rewinding snapshots doesn't really work in a concurrent user scenario. So can we do better? So this is basically what happens, what you just saw. All the asynchronous process gets interleaved by another actor moving the painting around. And if we then get the exceptions, we rewind everything, and we lose the changes related to the painting, etc. How can we do it properly? Well, basically, there are two approaches you can take. One is to record all the patches during the process. And if the process fails, just reverse apply those patches. And that sounds maybe quite complicated, but that's basically what the git revert command is doing for your source code. You generate the inverse of your old changes to effectively undo them. The other approach is to record the state at the moment you start your process, and you also record what actions are started. And whenever a process fails, you rewind to its starting state and then replay all the other actions which didn't fail. And both can be expressed using middleware. So let's first go for the second one. So this has happened. Three processes get spawned, gets interleaved by the continuing process. And if the process fails, we rewind back to the duck state, and we only replay the other actions which didn't throw exceptions. And so for that, I needs some middleware, which actually listens to all the actions. Because we really need to know about all of them. So I'm going to do the same. I pay a full visit. I move the painting around. At some point, the exception again occurs. The state is rewinded, but it starts replaying my changes. The changes which didn't fail, so I end up in the correct end state. And the way to express that is, again, pretty simple. We just create a stack of all processes that spawn. We store both the snapshot and the call describing the action invocation. And then if the process fails in the future, we find the original action that started or spawned the process. We apply its snapshot. We remove the rest of the replayed actions, skip the first one, and apply them again. So this is much more solid if you are in a concurrent user system. But actually, personally, I think that the batch-based approach is even better. And if you want to understand why, it's basically if you have ever done a Git rebase on a highly conflicting big refactoring, then you know why replaying actions is worse in the light of conflicts than applying patches. So let's go for the patch-based approach. That's what we use at Manix as well. So this is our IDE, in which you can build forums. And we can change some stuff. Oh, and the server's down. No connection properly. Sorry. But if you press Ctrl-Z, Ctrl-Z, we just inverse apply the patches we recorded during your actions. And that's how you can undo your own changes, even though changes from other people are coming in. So let's express that in middleware as well. So basically what you want to do is that every time our process continues, we start recording for that process which patches it produces. And then when the process throws, we don't rewind our state anymore. We just compute the inverse patches from what we did so far, and we apply those to the street, to the state. So the result of that is that we only see the non-failing changes. And so this is roughly what a recorded patch looks like during a full visit. So I add something to the pile, I change the relaxing state, I change the amount of toilet paper, and then the inverse of that is removing the same thing from a pile, swapping the states around, etc. So probably I have to show that that actually works. So for that we have the Atomic Async patch-based middleware. And now we can do the same trick. We pay a full visit. We drag the painting around. Throw the exception. And we see that the toilet state has been reset, but because to our only inverse patches, the painting is still at the place where we moved it. And this is roughly how that looks like. So when the process starts, we spawn, we create a recorder that just listens to the patch stream and stores all the patches for this specific process. Whenever it resumes, so that's when it enters a yield keyword, whenever the generator continues, we resume the recorder, and when that tick is done, we suspend the recorder again. And then in the end, if the process rejects, we just call undo, which applies all the patches in reverse to our state. So I can imagine that it is quite confusing to hear four different implementations of doing something atomic in roughly 50 minutes. And my goal today was not to teach you about how to properly do atomic updates, but to show you the power you have to reason about your data when you have patches available, when you have middleware available, and when you have snapshots available. And especially those patches are very powerful because they're so localized, so they don't conflict with anything else. And so all this middleware I've shown you so far, they don't relate to our bathroom application at all. They will work in any Mobix state tree. application. So it makes it very declarative, as middleware is supposed to be. So you can express all kinds of things like logging and time traveling, and atomic updates, as I've shown, optimistic updates, full undo redo implementations, etc. If you just have those three primitives to your disposal. So to summarize, Mobix State Tree is first and foremost a declarative, composable way to declare models describing your data and enrich them with actions and local state, etc. But it also provides powerful tools to make very generic abstractions. So in other words, Mobix State Tree is React. It's like Git, but for data. And now there's one thing left, and that is to flush out that shit. So for that, I hope my internet connection allows this. We're gonna release 1.0. Are you ready for that? So, 1.0. Now bear with me, dear internet. Wait for it, dear internet. Woo! It's available. Thank you.